is the Holy Spirit flame. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Hallelujah. So we're number one way is to be led by the Spirit, is to be the inward witness. You can expect the inward witness to speak to you. Everybody say amen. Romans 8, 14, 16, if many are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit, we're the sons of God. Hallelujah. We're not led by fleeces. Thank God. Now, I grew up Pentecostal. We all fleeced. I can't tell you how many times I heard as a kid, everybody talking about they put a fleece up out before the Lord. You know, you can't put a fleece out before the Lord. You're to be led by the Spirit, not by a fleece. And actually, most people who say they're putting a fleece out before the Lord didn't put a fleece out before the Lord. They put a test out. Because the fleece was from the lamb. And he hung it out there and said, if it's wet this morning and dry, and the next one he said, if it's dry and everything else is wet, and it was a lamb's fleece. Most people, they call it putting the fleece out, put a test out. Now, Lord, if there's coffee in my cup in the morning, I know it's you, but telling me to drink it. I'm being really silly now, but you get what I'm saying. If there's not coffee in my cup in the morning, I'm not supposed to drink it. God don't, anyway, we're under the New Testament. Are you here? Glory to God. We're to follow that witness. Psalm 18:20 says, "The light that will light my candle, the Lord my God, he will enlighten my darkness." When we begin to recognize and follow the inward witness, we do not go around looking for spectacular and miss the supernatural. Pastor Hagin used to say, don't miss the supernatural looking for the spectacular. If God is pressing upon your heart, you don't need seven prophets to confirm it. If God so chooses to use someone to confirm it, fine, but don't look for it. Learn to be led by the inward witness, knowing that God is speaking to you. Are y'all here? All right. Some people want somebody to walk in and say, yay, the Lord has sent me to tell you, and have three angels behind them with flaming swords pointing at the direction you're supposed to go. You're not going to get that. 99.9% of the people aren't going to get that. Amen. Not, you know, oh, I want an angel to appear to me. You keep asking for that, you might get one, but it won't be from heaven. Put a fleece out before the Lord, you might get fleeced. Are you here? They'll be led by the inward witness. Now, the number two way, we talked about inward witness last week, I'm just kind of getting this here, is the inward voice. Now, this is stronger than the inward witness. Paul wrote in Romans 9, when I say the truth in Christ and I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost. There's a difference between the inward witness and the inward voice. The inward witness is a knowing, an unction, basically that sense you're supposed to do something. The spirit of man does have a voice, though. It's called the conscience. Our conscience is it's the inward voice, not the voice of God. See, God can speak to you audibly. God can send an angel. That's not the number one way. Stop looking for the... I remember one time Brother Copeland was sharing after he read Brother Hagin's book. How many of you have ever read the book, I Believe in Angels? I Believe in Visions. I'm sorry, I Believe in Visions by Brother Hagin. If you hadn't, you go back and read it. It's a good book. Brother Copeland read that and started praying, Lord, I want you to appear to me. I want you. And he tried to manipulate the Lord. Started using the scripture. You're not a respecter of persons. You're not a respecter of persons, so I'm believing that you're going to appear to me like you did Brother Hagin. Finally, after he pounded on the Lord long enough, the Lord said, okay, I'll do it. It'll set your ministry back 10 years, and you might not ever recover. Why? Because he was trying to get a manifestation so that he could follow the manifestation. God usually will do certain things with people who can be trusted with it, and it won't affect them diversely. Amen? It won't mess them up. Some people, you hear them, they come out and they're, I saw Jesus, and they're homosexual. I went to heaven. Next thing, they built the whole ministry on. They went to heaven, and then they're homosexual. Hello? And their ministry has been a wreck. They made all kinds of money on it. People love to hear about heaven. So you can go tell people, I went to heaven, and make up some story, and people just go crazy over it. And you know what? Here's the thing I found out. A lot of the newer testimonies that they went to heaven, none of them match. One guy said it took him 7 days to get there and 7 days to get back. And he grew hair. Some of y'all remember him. He's about 25 years ago going around churches on teaching on how I went to heaven. And, you know, started sharing all kinds of stuff. He couldn't find Bible for it. Because he went to heaven, everybody wanted him. We want to hear about heaven. Well, let's just see what the Bible says about heaven. Let's stay with that. As a matter of fact, you're supposed to have heaven on earth. Okay. If y'all want to, can y'all grunt? Let me know you're breathing. All right. So, we need to know that the inward voice is our conscience. It does speak. And, you know, and your conscience will tell you, how many of you ever got ready to do something and your conscience said, don't do that? Wasn't an unction, not, it's just something that don't say, don't do that. That's your conscience. Now, let me say this. If you're not born again, your conscience is not a good guide. Why? It's seared. The carnal mind is enmity against God. Now, your conscience will say stupid stuff like, it's okay, God understands. Hello? Y'all hear you going home? You know, you got people running around there. You got, quote, preachers preaching for homosexuality. You know? North Carolina did not just pass homosexuality. Don't believe that headline. A federal judge overrode the state constitution and interfered in states' rights. He has violated the Constitution, but who's going to stop him? And our Congress don't have any gumption. North Carolina did not vote for homosexuality. Even our courts didn't approve it. A liberal-appointed judge came in and said, and just sits on his bench and goes, click, yours is unconstitutional with the federal, and you got to allow it. Well, his conscience isn't a good guy. Hey, are you here? People get together and say, my conscience is a good guide, and they're living in sin. No, your conscience isn't a good guide that way. You must be born again. Why? Because now the Spirit of God indwells you. Your spirit's alive unto God, and amen, and it speaks in harmony with the Spirit that indwells it. Can you say amen to that? Amen. Hallelujah. Paul said in Acts 23:1, and Paul earnestly beholding the council said, men and brethren, I have lived in all good conscience before God until this day. Now remember, before Paul got saved, his conscience wasn't good. He was breathing out threatenings and killing Christians and was doing it with zeal. He had letters to bring all those who were in that way bound. Are you here? He hated Christians. He wanted to feed them to the lions. But since he got saved, now his conscience is he's living good conscience before God. The voice of his spirit would speak in harmony with God. Even when he had not learned who he was in Christ. Remember, he wrote in Romans, the 7th chapter, and said, you know, with my mind I will serve the law of God. My body, my flesh, was resisting that. His conscience wanted to do right. He just didn't know how to do it until they had the revelation of who he was in Christ. If you're born again, if any man's a new creature, old things have passed away, all things become new, then your spirit is in tune or in harmony with God. But you have to renew your mind to the Word of God. So that you can, it's good to rightly discern the Word of God. It's good to know if it's Bible or not. we have a pastor friend. Now you all know Nathan went over to Wesleyan, and one of his good friends was a pastor's son, pastor of another church. Actually, was a pastor of a Baptist church, and they played baseball together and so forth. And he had a great quote this week, and the dad did, Pastor. It's Pastor Thornhill, New Life Community Church. You know, they're a Baptist church. He's a good man. Actually, his post lately has been really good. I've been enjoying him. You know, but listen to this. The glaring problem facing modern Christianity is Christians without Christian minds. While many Christians may worship and pray as Christians, they do not think as Christians. May we have the mind of Christ. And he quotes 1 Corinthians 2:16 and then Romans 12:2. Amen. Like Brother Hagin used to say, pretty good for Baptist. You know, of course, he could say that because he was Baptist at one time. Amen. Hallelujah. Actually, there's another one. Fear is a monster that wants to become your master. It can starve your faith and feed your doubt, but God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Trust him. He's faithful. Amen. Well, I agree with both of those. Fully. Amen. Amen. If I didn't know it was in a Baptist church, I think it was preaching in a Pentecostal, charismatic Word of Faith church. By those quotes, now they're good men, loves God, hallelujah. Really, really, really good pastor, good church. Amen. And but you know, notice the mind being renewed. You've got the witness of the inward voice speaks. But when you have the mind renewed to the Word of God, you know it's God speaking through your spirit. You got to know what the Bible says. You can't take what Brother Lunatic says. People get up and just preach for services and don't give you any Bible. No Bible? The Lord told me the other day. You're not led by what the Lord told them. Amen. We're led by the Spirit. And have enough sense that if somebody says the Lord told me, and you at least go be a Berean and go study it out and find out if it's what the Bible says about it. The Lord told me that you don't ever repent. That's a big thing in the new crazy grace church. You don't have to repent. That all of our sins, past, present, and future, are all covered. We don't have to repent for it. We're already covered. So what do? You just go out and do it? Okay, I did it, but I'm already washed, so I'm going ahead. No. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father. What's he do? He goes and argues your case for you. Now listen, let me say this. When they argue your case for you, they're not doing it without your consent and without your presence, as it were. They're arguing it for you. You're there. They're arguing the case on legal terms, but you've given them permission on how to argue. If you've committed sin, you have to repent. What does it mean? It doesn't just mean change your mind. Godly sorrow works repentance. Your conscience comes out of your heart. Remember what 1 John said? If our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God. Well, why would your heart condemn you? Your conscience would say you've done wrong. You need to get that right. The voice of your spirit would tell you you've done wrong. Let's get that right. As a matter of fact, the voice of your spirit was telling you before you did it not to do it, but you did it anyway, and then it said, you got to get that right. Amen. If you listen to that, you'll either stay out of trouble or get back out of trouble. Amen. Don't let just because somebody comes along and tells you that you don't have to do something, go find out what the Bible says. If the Bible says you're not supposed to do it, don't do it. Anybody here? Nobody's here? You're here. All right, I'm glad y'all are here. I'm here. So, if you're born again, the voice of your spirit, the inward voice, is a good God. Amen. God's on the inside of you. I was listening to Dad Hagin the other day. He said, you know, one of the great things about all the religions of the world that don't offer, no matter how big they are, how wonderful people think they are, one of them doesn't offer is God in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Jesus said, my Father and I will come and make our abode in you. Glory to God. God's on the inside. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Glory to God. And on the inside of you, your spirit is in tune with God, and there's a voice that comes out of that called the conscience, and if you'll listen to that, he'll lead you and guide you in the right ways. Somebody else say amen. 2 Corinthians 6:16, you're the temple of the Holy Ghost. The Spirit of God is at home on the inside of you. As you listen to your spirit, as your spirit listens to the Spirit of God, learn to follow after that. I've been in church services where people preach stuff I didn't agree with at all. Now, I didn't lead the church over it. You know, I had some guest speaker in and want something. I was in one church one time. Somebody said, have you ever prophesied to anybody? No. Everybody just turn around, lay your hands on and prophesy over. Now, I just kindly excused myself slightly and went out in the foyer and just kind of hung out until it was over. Two reasons. One, you know, you try to use the scripture, you may all prophesy one by one. I don't mean everybody can prophesy over everybody anytime you want to. You might get Looney Tune prophecy. And go listen to that, you get yourself in trouble. I can't be led by somebody giving me something. Or put something in me because they did that that affects my ability to hear, because that's always sitting there. We have to follow God. Can you say amen? All right. Hallelujah. Hindrances to hearing from God is a seared conscience. 1 Timothy 4:2 talks about people speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. 1 John 3:20 and 21 says, if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our heart and knows all things. Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God. We've got to keep our conscience pure, keep our heart pure, keep it clean, keep garbage out of it. Amen. Stay in communion with God. Stay in tune with God. Why? Because God wants to speak to you. Number one, through the inward witness. Number two, a higher voice, the inward voice or the conscience. He wants to commune with us and lead us and guide us. Amen. Remember the 23rd Psalm? He said, he leads me by still waters. He wants to lead us to places where it's good. He's not trying to lead you to the bad places. Now, he'll get you out of it if you get in there. If you'll listen to him, he'll get you back out of it. Like one guy said, man, if you're going through hell, don't stop. He says, some Christians get out, pitch a tent, and have a picnic lunch. Hello? No, if that's where you are, keep going, get out of there. It's no fun to hang out there. All right. You know, you have your body has a voice. Anybody know what the voice of the body is? Your feelings. I don't feel this, and I can't touch that, and I don't see. Reason is the voice of the mind, the unrenewed mind. What do you mean reason? You try to figure it out. Just like recently some, quote, Christian artist, quote, unquote, who won a Dove Award, la-di-da. Are you here? Got up and said, start talking about how the stories of the Old Testament were just really myths. You know, that Noah, it couldn't really be true. Now they're Dove Award winners, so they got a voice. Because there was no way that you could put all them animals on that boat. Really? So you don't believe in the supernatural God? Hello? See, he reasoned it out. That those things, you could be a Christian and not believe in the myths of the Bible. Well, I didn't have any records of his to throw out, but if I had, I would have thrown them out. I don't want to minister into my life. I don't want to sing it into my heart. No, I don't even believe the Bible's true. It's a myth. See, what got there? Reason. Try to reason it out. Remember Jesus spoke to the guys one day. Let the guy down, and he said, thy sins be forgiven. Then they began to reason among themselves. Who hath the power to forgive sins but God alone? He said, why reason ye these things among yourselves? But you may know that the Son of Man hath the power to forgive sins. He saith to the sick of the palsy, rise, take up thy bed and walk. Now, that'll mess up your head. How can saying, rise, take up your bed and walk, prove I got the power to forgive sin? See, when you get your mind involved, you get messed up. And the reason it was because it's going to be the same sacrifice that was paid for both of them. Amen. I said amen. But he said, I'm going to prove to you I have the power to forgive sins. Rise up and walk. And the carnal mind's going, there's a lot of space for that little BB in there called their brain to bounce around. Hello. Are you here? Now, he was the sacrifice sent to redeem us from sickness and the sacrifice sent to redeem us from sin. Hallelujah. Sickness is the result of his evil step-parent or evil parent sin. Now, that means that you sin, you get sick. It means that sickness came into the world because man's spirit became dead by sin. Therefore, it brought that destruction, not only from his spirit, but into his mind and into his physical body. And the manifestation of the sin that was in humanity in the body was sickness and disease. Hello. And a warped mind. Warped. Mr. Tuttle, whatever his name was in Gospelville. Got a warped mind. All right. Some of y'all didn't ever watch Gospelville. I had kids during the Gospelville era. We watch Gospelville and Nicodemus. Hallelujah. You've got help on the inside of you this morning. You're not helpless. You're not directionless. You're not without a voice to speak to you, glory to God. Amen. If we'll learn to tune in to the Holy Ghost by an inward witness or the inward voice, we can go way on down the road with God. Can you say amen? God's speaking to us through those venues and those means. They are the number one and two ways that he leads us by his Spirit. Oh yeah, he can appear in a flaming fire and have a mountain burn and all this kind of stuff. But you're not going to have that every day. And it happens to some Christians, they turn around and go the other way. They get afraid. Are you here? I mean, if an angel walked in your room, you'd probably start throwing holy water all over them. Get out the oil. Ha! 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 Are you here? You know I'm talking right. Won't even listen to God with the inward witness and the inward voice, but yeah, an angel show up and you're going to start throwing some kind of holy water or anointing oil all over him and running. And he said, I got a message from the throne of God. You done gone. Amen. Learn to be led by the inward witness. Don't override the inward witness and the inward voice. Don't turn aside when you sense something or God, your conscience is saying, don't just override that. What happens if you override it continually? You'll begin to sear yourself against that. Anybody ever gotten a callus or a place, you know, anybody gotten a, you know, like a cut or something and then it healed up with a kind of a little, that skin that, you know, and then you keep scratching everybody and callus it up. Guess what? You know what you find out about that? You can feel pressure on it when you scratch at it, but it doesn't have any feeling like it did. You seared it. Amen. It's gotten callous. Don't callous your heart against the voice of God speaking to you through the inward witness or the inward voice. Don't push those things away until you get callous. And then, I mean, he's got to take a sledgehammer to get your attention. Hello? Are y'all here? You going home? God wants to lead and guide you. God wants to take you into the deeper places. Glory to God. He speaks on the inside of us, either, you know, by the inward witness or the inward voice. Glory to God. Don't let the feelings of your body override the voice of God. Don't let the reason of your mind override the voice. Now, when I say the voice of God, we're talking about the inward witness and the inward voice, the conscience. God speaking to us in supernatural ways through these means, without having a manifestation of these means that he on a daily basis, he'll lead you by the inward witness or the inward voice. Daily. You might have a vision once in your life, might not ever have one. Angel might appear to you, angel may not ever appear to you. But on an everyday, moment by moment basis, you can live by the inward witness and the inward voice. Amen. And be led by the Spirit of God. And him take you, make you avoid things. Last night, now I'll be honest with you, I was coming up 73 and 74. I don't know if there's anything on 73 that I shouldn't have, maybe was going to run into or whatever. But I was getting closer and closer, and I normally come in on 73. Now, it's really about six, one way, half a dozen the other to go to the one coming back to my house. But I just normally just shoot rolling up 73 and come in and pick up 85 and come back down to Jamestown. And as I was getting closer and closer, it just kind of was going, you need to go 74. And just kind of impressed. And I was still thinking, I'm just going to go 73. And I got closer and got to the inward voice, you need to go 74. But, okay. Well, what happened on 70? It could have been a deer that was going to run out. I don't know. All I know is that I went from the inward witness to the inward voice, take 74 home. Now, I didn't get on the news to see if anybody got killed on 73 last night or anything. Who knows? If I had overrode it, it might be news this morning and been me because I overrode his voice. I just know I was supposed to go 74, so I went 74. How many of you ever had a sense to do something, you didn't do it, and then you ran right into a two-hour traffic jam? I have. I knew I was not supposed to come this way. How'd you know? God tried to tell you, dummy, but you went right on and did it anyway because it was 5 miles further to go the other way. Now, that 5 miles at 65 miles an hour wouldn't think in about 4.5 minutes. Now you're sitting here for an hour. Y'all know what I'm talking about. All right. Don't override that. Feelings. Don't let feelings get in your way. You have to shut your feelings or your body down. Your body is finicky. It could have woke up this morning and it did this for y'all. It said, let's go to church. And then some folks woke up this morning and said, let's stay in bed. And guess what they did? Don't fan the camera. We'll make a video record of who didn't do it, who did that. I'm teasing now. But your feelings can get you in trouble. I don't feel like this. I'm not led by my feelings. You don't do stuff because you got a goosebump. I've had TV on, one of those crazy horror movies come on, and you get goosebumps, and you know that an evil spirit is attached to that movie. Some of them are just stupid horror movies. Some of them are demonic. Now, I think all of them are spurred out of the region of the damned, but some of them are just demonically a demonic anointing on them. And you know, you could just sense it. Well, I don't get up and make a move over there. We're not going to put up with the devil. Hello. And I don't go see them. Paranormal activity. Some of that stuff is real. They're opening up to the devil. They get more, and more and more people are interested in manifestations of the devil. And the more you become interested, the more you become susceptible to it. Hello. That's all fake. No, I'm going to tell you something. You keep opening the door, mess around with it's like messing around with a Ouija board. You don't need to mess around with a Ouija board. You don't need to have one in your house. I know a lot of Christians used to do it all the time. We had one when I was growing up. Pentecostal grandmama. Pentecostal mama. Sit down and play with the Ouija board. And it say stuff. Oh, yeah. It say stuff. Oh, that was just No. You open the door to the devil and he'll do stuff. He'll manifest himself. Now, he's not going to show up to you in all of his demonic manifestation to start with. He'll start out with little Ouija boards giving you direction about stuff or telling you stuff. And everybody goes, oh, that's cool. Ain't cool. You're opening a door and a channel into the region of darkness to give authority of that into your life. That's why you don't go around looking for somebody to prophesy over you. Because if God's not in it, the devil sends somebody to give you a word. And the Bible says that Satan can manifest himself as the angel of light. Didn't say he was, said he can manifest that way. And so he can speak to you. And he can send people to you and say, my son and my daughter. Anybody can say my son or my daughter. Oh, that's God. Ain't God just because they said that. That's what they say line up with the Bible. Is it bearing witness to the lordship of Jesus Christ? Amen. No, we have to listen to the inward voice and the inward witness. If God tells you, if you just sense you're supposed to go a different way this morning, go a different way. Why? I'm just going to do what I want to do. Get you in trouble? Well, I went the other way. I didn't hear anything about a wreck or anything. No, because maybe you were going to be the one that had that wreck. Now, listen, last night I was coming home, coming up 38, got to Interstate 95. You're coming up towards Bennettsville. Got out and was on 38, South Carolina 38, coming up to 95. And this man had come off the interstate ramp and was sitting in the middle of the road in a black car. And the car in front of me almost ran right into a side. Well, I was slowing down to see what he was going to do because I didn't know what he was going to do. And about the time that car got almost up on him, he pulled right out in front of him. I mean, all the way around into his lane. And he's slamming all on brakes and blowing the horn and all this kind of crazy stuff. See, you just don't know what you're going to run into. You have to be listening to God. And I was just kind of hanging back. Normally, I don't like people to get in front of me or beside. I like to be out in front. But I had backed off. And was just kind of riding back a little bit over my lane, you know, two lanes, when that happened. Just felt like had this sense, back off. I backed off. Well, look, it wasn't a thing of, thou shalt back off. Just had this sense of back off. Don't press it, you know. Just had this sense, not to press it like I normally. I love to. I'm a leader. I like to be out in front. I don't like to lead from behind. I like to be out in front. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? But last night I just had back off. Okay. Listen to Dad Hagin on the authority of the believer. I'm just riding along and backing off, and then all of a sudden, if I'd been busting along pretty hard and not watching what I was doing and leading, I could have run right into him because you didn't see him real good. Black car in the middle of the road, sideways. So the headlights and the taillights weren't facing you. Like, that wasn't smart, man. Hallelujah. All right. So we're going to be led by the inward voice, the inward witness. We're not going to let feelings. Hello. We're not going to let feelings. And you know, whoever sang that song, Feelings, Nothing More Than Feelings. Who remember who we did that one? Anybody remember? Who is it, Melinda? Oh, I thought you. Nobody remembers Feelings? I don't think it was Bread. They were If. You know, everybody, when you got married in the 70s, you had to play If at your wedding. Even in 81, you had to play If at your wedding. How do you know? I had If at my wedding. Yes. Anyway, glory to God. All right, so next week we're going to start our 31 days to radically change your prayer life. Wednesday night we're going to keep teaching on the Apostle Paul. I'm not sure where I left off last week because we get going sometimes. But it's getting good. Amen. Hallelujah. I think we're in chapter 9 of Romans. I'm not sure if we got quite to the end. I don't think we got quite to the end of that. So we'll keep picking up. And that's a lot. That's the last of the long books of Paul. Then they move it to the shorter books. Okay? So we'll probably go through those a little quicker.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.